So thank you everyone, and thank you the speakers and Stuart for introducing a little bit the Art Strike, because my little talk is also connected with a lot of things. We get a glimpse this day. So thank you Ulla, thank you Leon, and thank you Marie-José for this invitation. And I like the show, I like this place, West, which is for me a warm-hearted collective exhibition place. And so it suits also to the things I think I want to talk about. In the following, I'd like to focus on an exhibition planned and realized by the art historian Kordelaf Rowein and Gustav Metzger and the artist Klaus Steck in Cologne in 1981. It's entitled Passiv-Explosiv, Entwurf einer Ausstellung. Passiv-Explosiv, a draft of an exhibition. Can everybody hear me? Yeah? Okay. And I like to show up how Metzger's conceptual steps leading to this collaborative project. So first I want to give a glance on his process of the proclamation of the art strike in 1974, his so-called Years Without Art, where Metzger tried to actively undermine the art market. And in the following, I will introduce his strategy termed art history with a gun, aiming to subvert the institutional art historiography. And finally, I'd like to outline his model of a museum, which was displayed in the exhibition Passiv-Explosiv, in which he counteracts the established notion of the museum as a preserving institution. So I want to start, So I like to start with a quote of Hugo Burger. He was the general director of the museums of the city of Cologne, and in his preface of his catalog Westkunst, West Art, which took place at the same time like Passiv-Explosiv, he stated the following: contemporary art is, whenever it transcends the private sphere, museum art. The museums in particular has become a place that invest artworks with a persisting presence. In addition, museums grant space more than any other place for the rehabilitation of art. These words must have stirred up vehement opposition on Gustav around 10 years prior to this, in 1972, Metzger had expressed in his article from the City Pages in Studio International the discontent of many artists, including him, about exhibiting within the public art scene. I quote, "Now many artists oppose the government and the kind of society it seeks to foster, and there is therefore inevitably a sense of compromise when accepting money or invitations to exhibit from organizations whose source of finance is ultimately government money. To some extent, I have managed to resolve these conflicts by showing works which represents my political views, which is aimed at changing society, and which at the same time seeks to alter the habitual usage of the gallery or museum and the expectations that visitors bring to these institutions." So Metzger intensified his criticism when he used the exhibition Art into Society, Society into Art in 1974 as an opportunity to call this 3-year-long art strike with the intention to warn the art market and in particular the gallery owner, museums and media complex. There he wrote, "These years without art will see the collapse of many private galleries. Museums and cultural institutions handling contemporary art will be severely hit, suffer loss of funds, and will have to reduce their staff. National and local government institutions for the financing and administration of contemporary art will be in serious trouble." 2 years later, Metzger radicalized his demand in his article Art in Germany under National Socialism in Studio International by switching from passive to active resistance, a most aggressive struggle against the established strongholds, art historical institutions, art schools, art magazines, art dealers, museums, art councils, etc., is essential. Metzger called one of the weapon that he introduced in this struggle art history with a gun. This was a strategy with which he sought to subvert and overrule established art history and the codifying institutions like the museum. At the same art history that supports the prevailing political discourse, since it is supported by it in return, or in Metzger's provocating phrasing, art history has been an instrument which upheld the sacredness of art and social institutions. It bolstered the cash and prestige value of collection. It distorted reality and history in every conceivable way in order to uphold the status quo. Art history is produced by the political neutered for the eternally unsatisfiable. Metzger had been occupied with the systematic functionalization of art in the National Socialism, with the exhibition Kunst im Dritten Reich, Dokumente der Unterwerfung, Art in the Third Reich, Documents of Subjugation by Dr. Georg Busmann at the Frankfurter Kunstverein, 1974, the same year where the Art and Social Society happened. In his preface of the catalogue, Busmann encouraged to critical examine art as to its exploitation by the government, even in his times. Busmann wrote the following. If art, exemplified here by the National Socialist art, should be fundamentally identified with its epoch and form of society, such a methodology is also valid for other epochs. Also, there is no appreciable continuity of an S art in the present day, the continuity remains in its function. If art in the Third Reich has the task of distorting reality and destroying any awareness of it, the question is, what relationship to reality does art have today? By art history with a gun, Metzger was directly referring to that approach and henceforth tasked a decided politically militant counterposition to the prevailing discourse of art history. Metzger was trying to further substantiate his method on an analytical level through the symposium A Gun, or AGUN, that he co-organized together with Cordula Frohwein, a curator at the Jewish Museum in Frankfurt am Main, and whose acronym title already alludes the art history with a gun. While Metzger was adamant in no longer waiting to show art after his Years Without Art from 1977 to the 1980s, he incorporated his artistic means of expression into his curatorial practice. The integration of his artistic language and of his intellectual strategy of an art history with a gun reappears in an exhibition from the year 1981 in Cologne, entitled, as I said, Passiv-Explosiv Entwurf einer Ausstellung. This exhibition was designed as a counter-project to the first major blockbuster exhibition Westkunst, West Art in Cologne, which, at a budget of 7 million Deutsche Mark, by all means competed with other international large-scale events such as Documenta. At that time, 7 million. Many artists criticized Westkunst since it not only squeezed the art of the 60s and 70s into conventional museum structures, but also because the excluded political committed art almost completely was completely put out and excluded. Passiv-Explosiv Entwurf einer Ausstellung was meant to uncover Westkunst's distortive method of art historiography. The artist, Klaus Steck, here in the middle, after holding a public discussion, co-founded a collective together with Gustav Metzger and Cordula Frohwein with the intention to develop a counter-concept to the large-scale event. Metzger co-determined this collective significantly, and it can be entirely understood in the spirit of his art history with a gun. While Westkunst ended up with its presentation of the art in the 70s by excluding also the present, Frohwein, Metzger and Steck started right here
with their exhibition at the Hahn-Toborg in Cologne. They displaced the display showing the title words passive explosive, gave the visitors a glance of the actual threat they were living in. Below the word passive, there was a complete copy of the booklet Protect and Survive, published in 1980. Thus, with its front and back side, so two copies, pinned up. The booklet illustrated possible ways of domestic protection in the case of a nuclear strike in an undeniable, naive fashion. Left of it, below the word explosive, there was a copy of the booklet Protest and Survive by E.P. Thompson, pinned up the same way. This pamphlet appeared in the same year and called for a nuclear-free Europe. With this display, Metzger showed an artistic intervention that, fully in the line of his idea of art history with a gun, actively opposes the subversive means the prevailing opinion. Thompson's booklet cover figures as an ironic mimicry of Protect and Survive. At the same time, Gustav also deployed his own artistic approach within his curatorial presentation. Just like in his work with newspapers, the exhibition reveals literally at one glance the entire publication with his inherent worldview. Metzger had already envisaged these types of works, which originally followed primarily an up-to-date principle for the 1962 Festival of Misfits in London, but he did not receive the permission to implement it there. In the same room, the so-called Strukturraum, structure room, Frohwein, Metzger and Steck used a multitude of photocopies and printed material in order to demonstrate the socio-political movements that were left out by Westkunst. There was an acrylic glass showcase, Metzger called it the Book Tower, or the Tower of Books, designed by him, stretching from the floor to the ceiling, in which he had placed books. The visible book covers referred to socio-political relevant topics, such as war and peace, unemployment, youth revolt, drugs, and environmentalism, as he wrote in his preface to the exhibition. These topics were meant to be available for the analysis of current day art without prescribing compulsive arrangements or completeness. The whole exhibition covers six rooms, also in a loose order, but each of them was highlighting a tendency left out by Westkunst. There was a textile room, features documents about happening fluxes, psychedelic art, etc. There was a kinetic room for kinetic art informed about concept and technological art and so on. There was a room for interaction and for political art. On the second floor of the building, right above the just indicated structure room, there was a room called museum room. Metzger gave an entitled description of that museum room in his project outline of the 12th of June in 1981 at the BBK, the Professional Association of Visual Artists. And one detail of this description gives also a hint of the construction of Metzger's book tower, the room below. In the outline, Metzger envisaged that the museum's room would provide a space for engagement with fundamental questions regarding the genesis, communication, and reception of art. The room was supposed to outline the, and I quote, evolution of the museum as well as the rejection of the museum emerging in the 20th century by movements such as Futurism, Dada, Tatlin's Tower. Tatlin's Tower, as Metzger wrote, was a revolutionary step to convey information, that he quote in this text. Originally, this tower of glass and steel was planned to show in its daily rotating dome news magazines, announcements and manifestos, partly by means of technical media such as telephony, telegraphy, or radio broadcasting in connection with loudspeakers. Tatlin also envisaged light projections at night or in cloudy weather. In the exhibition text, Metzger describes his book showcase in this first draft in the structural room with the following words: a tower of glass contains book about current topics. In doing so, the suggestion parallels to Tatlin's Tower, which however did appear only in the first edition of the outline, and puts forward an attack on Westkunst by this recourse of the art of the East. In the draft, there was a decisive criticism. Metzke drew attention to a generation of artists active during Westkunst's very period of investigation, from 1939 to 1972, who just like him strongly opposed the institution of the museum. So I quote, "There are many artists after 1955 who do not want or are not able to work in museums or galleries. It is especially in view of this trend that it is not represented in Westkunst that Metzke asked himself, and I quote, how can we present these new movements within the art in museums and galleries? For this purpose, he developed a model, a museum for today and for the future, which would serve, according to Metzke, and I quote, as a place of new interactions between art, artist, and society. And that provided room in which, and I quote, new technical and aesthetic possibilities within the arts can be demonstrated. This is the model in the second floor of the Hahn Torborg, the so-called museum's room, in which this model stands. And the advertising text of Passiv Explosiv described the model and the section for museum room. The idea of a museum is introduced. Passiv Explosiv poses the question, how can art that is ephemeral be adequately presented? Four examples for rooms which with flexible exhibition facilities, they are only part of the museum space that is available to impart the art that is no longer existing. The four rooms provided opportunity for room one, action. Room two, works with water, the material can rise up to the ceiling. Room three, destruction room, the material can be destroyed, and where the wall, the ceiling, and the floor can be destroyed and restored again. Room four, technological facilities of air pressure, laser, electronics. The laboratory is integrated into the museum. All four rooms are accessible from the central core. The rooms are available to artists. Works of the past are reconstructed. Passiv Explosiv wants to impact the planning of museums. The magazine room, showing in the model, however, was left out of the written description. This seems odd, as the model was very likely earlier planned and realized as the press release. Possibly Metzke doesn't want to underline this importance of this room because the model is a common current room of museums. But just like the other rooms, it was non-hierarchically accessible from a center core, so the audience could decide. It may seem paradoxical once again that Gustav now in return presented a model of a museum for today and for the future in a counter exhibition to Westkunst, whose conventional museum setting was likewise criticized strongly. The special focus on ephemeral art suggests that Metzke does not design a universal, purely abstract countermodel. Instead, his concept appears to have accrued from his own artistic practice, a practice that the museums had been refusing to support. This contradiction in particular once again reflects Metzke's dialectical approach. Similar to his attack on the established art history through art history with a gun, Metzke now passes criticism on museum situations by means of his own vision of the museum. In doing so, he was intending to extend, to subvert, even to explode the unusual mode of presenting and representing, the usual mode of presenting and representing art. The destruction room proposes in the model of 1981, in which even the infrastructure can be destroyed and restored again, appears a little bit as a logical extension of his concept of the autodestructive art. Art seems to be allowed to ultimately appropriate even the museum and to destroy it at least partially. Yet the structural integrity of the museum architecture appears to be in contradiction to the notion that Metzger formulated in the before shown first draft of Passive Explosive. In this draft, he describes the museum, and I quote, as a museum, as a place of new interaction between art, artist, and society, which prompts the idea of a much more open structure that would branch out into the social sphere. With the clause, and I quote, the model shows rooms in which new technical and aesthetic possibilities in the arts can be demonstrated, Metzger perhaps aimed not so much at the classical notion of a preserving museum, as at these ephemerally set up performances and presentations before and with the audience, his so-called lecture demonstrations. Metzger's rejection of conventional museums, which vehemently set in during the 1970s, manifested itself as an appropriation of the museum in a similar manner to his art history with a gun, as a counter art history in order to undermine it. The insistence of this confrontation becomes a part if we compare Metzger's statement in the City Pages from 1972 about a temporal distance. His suggestion to only exhibit art, and a quote, which is aimed to changing society and which at the same time seeks to alter the habitual usage of the gallery or museum and the expectations that visitors bring to these institutions, almost 10 years later find a renewed echo in the formulation, and a quote, passive explosive wants to impact the planning of museums. And even more concrete in the first shown draft, one of the goals of the exhibition is to stimulate discussions about the planning of museums. The planning of Museum Ludwig, for example, in Cologne. So again, an unrealized project. Metzger includes not only his early ideas about the artistic material he once worked with into this model of a museum in room entitled Water. For example, the material Metzger wrote could rise up to the ceiling. The room appears to have its antecedents in the works with water, which Metzger worked in the exhibition Extreme Touch, we already know from John. And yes, in 1968 in Swansea, and Lissy. A direct reference to this former project can be seen in particular in the room that is entitled Laboratory. The explanation to this room are, in comparison to the others, the most elaborate. They read almost like a summary of Metzger's exhibition Extreme Touch in the filtration laboratory at the University College of Swansea, in which he already used, and I quote, technological facilities such as air pressure, laser, electronics, he mentioned later in his outline in 1981. According to Metzger's model, however, art does not move into the laboratory as in 1968, but the laboratory is integrated into the museum and is made available to artists. It makes full sense that Metzger, in a model museum for today and for the future, integrates around the same time the artistic possibilities on which he worked since the 1960s and which had been made difficult or had been denied to him. But it seems odd that the model was placed in front of a wall that featured photocopies and posters on the topic of war and destruction. One poster was the iconic anti-Vietnam War poster of the Art Workers Coalition, showing the death of a massacre in Vietnam with the overwritten quote, question, and babies? Answer, and babies. Further documentary photographs like the iconic war photography of the Vietnam Napalm Girl from the Vietnamese US-American photographer Nick Ut alternated with pictures of bomb explosions and soldiers. The presentation featured also a photocopy of Picasso's Guernica with a number of close-up views. The setting appeared like a synoptic representation of war and destruction as mediated within the context of the museum and the media. At first glance, it seems enigmatic what the connection might be between the museum model on the one hand, which emphasizes primarily the technological possibilities in art, and the documentation of violence and war on another, on the other side. Yet we can find a possible answer to this question in Gustav Metzger's 1969 text Automata and History from the Studio International. In this article, Metzger demanded the same manifold technological possibilities that he would later illustrate in his 1981 model, and which were meant to be available to artists. At the same time, he explained in this article why artists and artist collectives in particular should be given the means to actively partake in technological progress. According to him, only free access to advanced technologies, the offer to work with and to understand them, enables one to ethically and morally question them, by doing so to impact their abuse for warlike purposes. Even, or shall I say again in our times, where the threat is arising once again, the passage of Metzger's article, I like to end with, is a call for action. To overcome individual anxiety, to get informed, to act collectively against the system of power turning the world to destruction. So Metzger wrote, to fight the social system whilst also demanding unhindered access to expensive technologies, materials, sources of information, and technical and physical assistance is too difficult a task for individual artists, but collectively such a program is realizable. That is why political and moral issues need to come to the foreground in art and technology organizations. Such organizations whose programs do not include a concern with fundamental social change are already outdated, and many ultimately be discredited. World leaders and government spokesmen have said too many times that they are unable either to control war or defend their nations from annihilation in a nuclear war. Thank you for your attention. And yes.